This 1957 novel, penned by Ayn Rand, Atlas Shrugged, has become the Bible for a lot of small government libertarians. For the most part, the book is a fictional account of an American society in which all of the industrious people, the hard workers, leave and go start a new society, mostly because all of the leeches and big government have taken over capitalism and commerce. Now, it's a fictional account, but why does it resonate with so many conservatives in today's society? Well, take this for instance. I'm a middle-class small business owner. I pay more in withholdings every month to the government than I do to my church and to charities, than I do on my mortgage, or than to feed my four children. My parents, who are lower middle class, can't even sell an old rental house that we grew up in because the government would make more money than they would. So what we see is government is expensive. There comes a point where it costs to have government. Recent studies show that you could tax 100% of millionaires, 100% of their money, and it would only fund the federal government for 4 months. So the middle class, you're on the hook, and it's just a matter of time before we run out of money. That's your Man Up moment. Join us Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays on WTNB Television for Man Up America. Also simulcast on Talk 101.3 The Buzz. I'm the good Dr. J. Adams.
Are you looking to refinance your home, or perhaps you're in the market to actually purchase? Take it from the good Dr. J. Adam. There's no need to go far and wide to look for mortgage help. Call 339-8086, Home Mortgage Solutions, LLC, right here in Cleveland. Their team's prepared to help you with lending, with refi options. Just give them a call, 339-8086, and tell them the good Dr. J. Adam sent you. The good Dr. J. Adam here, talking to all the gentlemen out there. For those of you with wives, girlfriends, even mothers, which would make all of you, you need to call 423-472-8887 and talk to the good folks at Bliss Day Spa. Nothing says I love you like the special treatment, the VIP treatment of the services of Bliss Day Spa. Call them today, 423-472-8887. Tell them the good doctor sent you from Man Up America.
Woodman Life has been keeping its promises to members for more than 100 years. That means we've survived the Great Depression, Black Friday, and all the other ups and downs our economy has faced. In good times and bad, we're strong and stable. We're an organization your family can count on. At Woodman Life, we've always believed that slow and steady really does win the race. Our conservative investment philosophies are just one part of the strength of our organization. What really makes Woodman Life strong is the trust and loyalty of our members.
Contact your local Woodman representative today by calling 423-790-2847. With three offices serving Southeast Tennessee, your Woodman representative is standing by to help you.
Woodman of the World Life Insurance Society of Omaha, Nebraska. Woodman Life, standing strong for generations.
So, how's the new job?
Love it. But it's not just a job, it's a career.
Life insurance? Love?
I told you Woodman Life is really active in the community, right? They support all kinds of community improvement projects. How's your job, by the way?
Don't ask.
Begin your financial career today with Woodman Life by calling 423-790-2847.
Woodman of the World Life Insurance Society of Omaha, Nebraska. Woodman Life, standing strong for generations.
The DJ accepts no responsibility for the next record.
Say what?
Oh no, he's there.
Where's the money, man? Where's my money?
It's time to Man Up America.
Let's do this.
We are live, WTNB Studios, right here in Cleveland, Tennessee, for Man Up America. I've got Mitch in the house.
How are you?
One bald guy with a beard and another bald guy with a beard on his way.
True story.
That's what's going to happen today. I'm glad you're listening to us on Talk 101.3 The Buzz, WTNB, Charter Channel 5, Comcast 210.
So many channels.
Digital TV station 27.1.
So many channels.
Rob Alderman.
Yo.
We are.
What?
Facebook Live-ing.
Oh, my gosh. So
right
happy.
Now, as we speak.
I'm happy.
So if you want to forward the link, once again, you can watch us Facebook Live.
I did. On WTNB's page. I told people a minute ago that we were on.
We're going to forward that on the Man Up page as well. So we are Facebook Live-ing at the moment.
That's sweet.
Which has been great. It's almost quadrupled our viewership.
Oh, man.
Yeah. From four
surprised.
To people to 16.
I know.
16
no
people?
Joking.
16 of you?
No, I'd say it in jest. We've got a tremendous response on Facebook, yeah. And I think folks find it easier to remind them to watch the show than going over to YouTube.
The thing is that they are already not working being on their Facebook, right?
So like, why not? That's just what they're take already an hour doing. Out like, of your day.
Well, the thing is, if you're going to go ahead and cheat on your work, then stay in the same browser.
That's right.
They don't want to open up two
don't
browsers.
Don't swap over to Pinterest. Just hang out with us for
that's
an
right.
hour.
They want to just
like,
stay
it's
here.
One thing to have Facebook up, but Facebook and YouTube?
Yeah,
right.
Come on.
You know, come on. That's,
well,
that's too much.
Well, it's funny because after we were on Steve Hartline's show, you know, and
who's
I
that?
shared the link on my Facebook page, people were like, we didn't even know this was a thing. How long
hold on,
have
who,
you been doing this?
Whose show?
You know, the,
and
that
you were
other
like,
show.
And Mitch, you were like, I have been doing this for like 2 weeks.
And they were like, well, how long have you been doing this? And I'm like, I don't know.
My whole adult life.
Since like November.
You have to give us more history.
Right.
If you're going to do that, what's it, provenance, right?
Yeah.
Okay,
right.
So just build it. Just say 4 or 5 years.
Right, and they were like, well, we didn't even know. And I'm like, almost.
Everyone's
like,
listening,
I
Buffy.
So I'm looking on our Facebook Live thing right now to see if, like, or on our Facebook to see if there's a if it, we're live, but we're not yet.
Well, we are live.
No, we're live, but I'm just saying we're not.
Oh,
not
I think
on the
Man
Up post,
delay.
We're live in right now. I don't know if livin's a word, but in North Carolina, it would sell.
It's livin'.
You mentioned the illustrious Steve Hartline.
I
got to give our viewers and listeners an update on what's going down with the Steve Abonza, or whatever we call him now.
Oh, yeah,
so
here it is.
This weekend, he texts me,
this.
Hey, when are we going to take up this challenge? I'm ready for you. I've been stretching for 48 hours.
Right.
And so I tell him, I was like, whenever, boss. So I give him several times.
Right.
None
I said,
of those work for
and it kind of went like this. How about anytime Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday,
sure.
Saturday,
anytime.
Sunday?
It's almost disparaging how much I look like a giant compared to the two of you. It's like ogres are
you,
real.
We've already established you are Yukon Cornelius.
This is so disappointing, Facebook Live. Everybody knows that the camera adds 50,
it's
60
the
pounds.
Camera angle.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
there's
the camera adds.
It's all about the angle.
100 pounds
totally
or so.
Fine.
It's all about the angle. So Rob wasn't with us last week when we
right?
when we did the video breakdown.
I'm sure he saw it on Facebook Live,
of
though.
Steve Hartline's half court shot.
Right.
Yeah, I saw
it. So the challenge has been issued, and we are on the verge of, he and I just duking it out over a game of horse. So I say, Steve, bring it, whenever. Monday,
no,
Tuesday,
wait
Wednesday.
A minute, wait a minute.
Whenever, right?
Anytime.
You say.
Whenever.
Anytime, because this is Man Up America,
I would, the latest update is, I can't do that. I can't do that time.
I like, can't do any time?
I can't do whenever.
I can't. That whenever doesn't work for me, Lo.
But when you Steve say Hartline. You and him duking it out, you do mean like on Facebook Live.
I'm
so
Steven.
Everyone can see.
Listen,
right?
We've got. It's like my I have
just
all.
Just a yelling Steve Hartline voice.
Go for it.
I'm just like, you guys keep having your conversation. I'll just entertain myself. Hey, what are you talking about?
Shut up, Bridget.
Do you remember, like, when all I used to do was call her a moron? Moron! You morons! And then, like, everybody would, like, call into the show and be like, why are you so mean to that nice girl?
Oh,
Bridget's precious. Why are you so mean to that nice girl?
So, well, I'm going to bring
I can't do any time!
I'm going to bring some humility to Steve's life.
Woo!
If whenever's a good enough time for him.
Right. Those are strong words, but I'm for it.
Pick a date, Steve. Quit pushing it off. You know, he's been out
anytime.
In the... I've got video evidence, too. Drone footage, actually. Of him practicing in his driveway.
This drone,
they say
rare drone footage.
He's beat himself 3 times on Game of Force, so he's feeling pretty good about himself.
I believe you have, sir.
Well,
good
for him.
There's
good
the update on the challenge. Right. We hope to have that sometime this week.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I can't do it.
I got to get it in before knee surgery.
What is knee surgery?
You know what? Knee surgery. I'll do it the same day as knee surgery.
Is there for real knee surgery for you?
Maybe. Maybe. So, listen... I'm
waiting
on the whenever.
Random surgeries?
Just random. Well, you know, trying to better myself.
I'm getting a little older. It's time for some random surgeries.
When you go to the doctor in the next room, you hear them say, we can rebuild him. We can make him better.
Yeah. We have the technology.
We have the technology. So we're here. Man up. It's a new week. Obviously, been a weekend flooded full of headlines.
Yeah.
I will say we've got an excellent – we pre-recorded a show on Friday that will air this week. With Brian Graves of the Cleveland Daily Banner, in which he's going to talk a little bit about his plans to be at the presidential inauguration this week. And he talks a little bit about an article he wrote a couple of weeks ago in Sunday's Banner that was very critical of people creating news on social media. And so we had an excellent dialogue, so I expect everybody to tune in on Thursday.
I'm sorry I missed that one.
Man, I'm telling you, it was right up your alley, as was the video breakdown of Steve
Hartline. And I like Graves.
Yeah,
I want to say that. Like, I like Graves, so I don't know that he and I have always fallen on the same side of issues. But
well, he's objective,
and
you're not.
We mostly
so.
Do. What? That's just not true.
So, Brian, great. I think it's a great show. It'll air on Thursday.
I wish you would write an article about how at some point we'll be able to read an article from the Daily Banner online. That would be
good instead
word.
Of
like how about this? Ready, Graves? Ready, Graves?
We used to be able to read
I'm in a mood today, dude. I'm in a mood today. So, Graves, are you ready?
Dial it back, save it for Trump.
If you don't want people creating their own news online, make your news
online.
Available online.
It
That's
used
revolutionary.
To be. They changed it because I think it was
just, game changer.
They were sucking their subscriptions out because people were reading online.
Yeah.
So
it's because news is different.
Right.
And paper and ink is different.
It is very different.
I mean, this is sorry to bring up a 10-year-old conversation.
it's okay.
Anyway, I like the Daily Banner, and I really do like Graves.
Well,
but
the
but you like it online.
I'm just saying you can't. You are not allowed to complain about digital news
if you're
if
not
you
a part
are not
of it.
Willing
sure.
to engage in digital
engage
news.
In digital
sure.
news.
Fair
okay,
enough, fair
I got
enough.
It. Yeah. I don't think Brian.
His response would be, of course, we're available online for a subscription.
No, I think his article was much more to the tune of what's problematic with people creating news rather
a lot.
Than
a lot. Is
yeah,
problematic.
Yeah. There's a whole.
That's
lot.
That's why I said he and I are agreed.
We are definitely going to tackle
mood.
That.
I'm in a mood, Graves.
We man up pretty big time on that. We even break down some local created news.
Well, I can't wait to watch
show.
It.
Have you seen the video of the bus traveling down the road that somebody was following the school bus?
Yes.
We talk about that.
We do.
That was fantastic.
All 1,400 shares of something that may or may not be
right.
anything
really
other than a
weird.
Video of a bus.
Yeah, it was like a really fun. After this guy jumped out in front of me, I took a film of him being dangerous to children. Sheriff?
Yeah.
And the sheriff is like, by all means, like, turn this into the local bus barn.
And then it's like, so first
the
of all.
The sheriff did something very sheriffy.
Where
like,
was,
still go after bad guys and let this video
yeah,
be.
Yeah. where are the children? And B, what danger? You know, it's kind of. So, yeah, we man
up on
that. I do
think he, like, crossed the yellow once a little as he's going around a corner. Go get him. Go
he
get
was,
him viral.
He was obviously texting. You could see it through the
the
two
it.
Layers of sheet metal and
the children
glass.
Are in danger.
I don't know.
Save the children.
Okay. I have a strict no bus policy for my children, so, you know, this doesn't really affect me.
Doesn't affect you, Mitch?
Right. Wherever you need to go, I will take you. I'll take all your friends.
Out in Central Illinois, we just hook up the carriage.
Right.
Go just through the field or to the school.
Hey, there were plenty of days where there were tractors in the parking lot.
We stop by the malt shopping. We take wooden rings and push them with sticks to see how long they'll stand on one end. What is video?
Oh, goodness.
Mitch, no love lost today.
Well, you know.
Before we hate on you too much.
All love.
Let's talk about love a little bit.
Yeah, let's do it.
Where love does not exist, evidently, according to the Washington Post, is between our president-elect and the people of the U.S. To which Trump's immediate response is, because lies. Them polls was so correct the first go-around.
That's right. Right. And you know what? When I saw that tweet, which we... Can we all admit, like, Trump has single-handedly saved Twitter? Like, the CEO of Twitter
it's
is like,
right. I love this guy.
Like, I picture
Trump
they,
is the reason I got on Twitter, like, so obviously
when
it's
they,
working
when they
for
share,
them.
Like, the Twitter behind the scenes, like, 10 years from now, there's going to be a dramatic scene where the CEO is just about to sell it for next to nothing, and his hand is coming down to the paper, and they suddenly grab his hand, and they go, stop! Trump won. He won the election. We're saved. So
I don't know. Maybe there's some metrics that you can pull, Mr. Social Media Man, to tell us just exactly how much traffic Shea Donald pulls to Twitter.
Oh, sure. Yeah, I'll bring those in next time.
There's
lots of really good articles. But here's the point. When I saw his tweet about, like, these are the same pollsters are the same people who said I was going to lose.
Right.
It was literally the first tweet he's made that I had to agree with a little.
Yeah, we were like, yeah.
I was like,
yeah.
Boy, that guy is a little bit correct.
Yeah.
Not so off his rocker.
I'm kind of with him on that. I don't know if I trust any polling right now.
Right.
Yeah,
Until I see a good solid white paper to explain why it was so bad.
Right. Yeah.
The last go around. I mean, there's been a lot of speculation on the news outlets and the 24-hour news circuits. But for the most part, no one's adequately explained why the data was so
here. Here's what I think. I think you can't explain the shy Trumpers, like we said on our show.
Mm-hmm.
I think they'll never – here's the thing, real brief. They'll never have the data. And the reason they'll never have the data is because the shy Trumpers are still not talking about it.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And they're never going to talk about it because they're like middle-class private people who don't talk about it. Like that's
well,
so I don't
you,
think the data's
if you
coming.
Look at the data, like the actual breakdown, women was way down in each of the categories polled. Women are not liking him right now.
And they don't want to talk about
they
how they voted for the guy they didn't like.
Right. My question is, how is that any different than what
there
we
was
saw
a, I won't say names. I won't say names, but my wife is squarely in this demographic and I'm not talking about who she voted for, but I am going to talk about a friend of hers.
Okay.
So there.
So that was
discussion.
Interesting how you phrased it. I'm not going to say names, but I'm going to reveal, A, my wife, who obviously has a name we can discover.
What I'm saying is she has a friend.
Okay.
And they're
we'll
discussing.
Call her Patty.
Right?
I'm asking
Let's
for
talk
a
about
friend.
Patty. Right.
Okay.
Let's talk about Patty.
All
right,
Patty.
And so my wife is having this conversation with Patty, and I'm doing the thing, right? You and I have been on the air, and we've been doing this thing. So I'm all around the house, the shy Trumpers, right? Like, and she's like, well, tell me what the shy Trumpers are. And I'm like, this is the shy Trumpers. And she goes, oh, Patty,
right?
My friend Patty was just over here. We're having this discussion. And she got really quiet, and she said, and there I was in the booth, and God help me, I voted for him. I know he says these horrible things about women, and I don't want my sons to be anything like him, but, I mean, I've been a conservative my whole life, and God help me, I pulled the lever for the man, right? And, like, right, here's the deal. That happened over and over and over and over and over again.
Right.
We think.
Right.
Once again, we think. We
and
suspect.
I think there are those Republicans,
that's a good,
right,
too,
we suspect
that voted for the party, not for the
that's
person.
Right. And we'll never be able
to necessarily
right.
agree with him.
We'll never
but,
have the data.
Right.
We'll never have the data.
So now we have this poll that says Americans don't like the president-elect. In fact, I love how it's funny.
Take a poll of how
the
many
more
people
liberal
a,
the news source.
Take a poll of how many people own a Nickelback CD.
Yeah, that's right. The more liberal.
You know they're sold. There's
right?
millions sold, but you can't find millions of
people. Can't
find
anybody owns one? It's like a Creed CD. I've got the first Creed album.
What? What?
But it's interesting, the more liberal the news outlet, the more liberal the headline.
Right.
So
sure,
the Huffington Post actually worded it like this. Trump sees historical lows in polling. And I'm like, how much history of polling do we have?
Yeah.
But that's kind of the news of the day. Everybody's kind of pushing it on social media. Of course, the big attack is Do we attack the commander-in-chief or elect, or do we attack the actual polling? And depending on where you are in the debate, you know, we last week on the show, and I think we hit the article, we actually bring it up again in Brian Graves' segment, we talked a lot about the article that investigated how doctors really felt about Obamacare.
Right.
And it was directly tied to their partisan affiliation and age. And we were like, okay, newsflash, you know. But that's where we are. You know, Trump is doing what he does. Some people like it and some people don't. Through this past weekend, though, one of the American sacred cows, and I know this has got Rob's beard in a tizzy,
right?
Was attacked when the satirical source, otherwise known as Saturday Night Live, obviously went too far enough for Trump to hit the Twitter.
Right.
And lash out at their poor quality and how they're bad TV right now. Now,
cancel them. It's terrible TV.
I think there's a lot of people.
His tweet was like, NBC is fake news. And worst of all, Saturday Night Live.
I love it.
Horrible.
I was like this. Saturday Night Live is fake news.
Right.
Really?
And then really. It just says sad, period. What's sad about it?
Well,
sad about it.
I think most people can agree that SNL has struggled to maintain the glory it once had. And it's been rescued by personalities through the past several years. Not necessarily personalities on the program. I think of Justin Timberlake. Mm-hmm. Justin Timberlake, obviously not a member of the cast, but his window of appearances over a few years really bolstered
hilarious.
Ratings.
Yes.
Yeah, he bolstered ratings.
John Hamm.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Now, I do tend to agree with Donald that Saturday Night Live appears to be reaching for really low-hanging fruit, spending so much time with Alec Baldwin and his character.
Right.
A lot of it does get old, especially people who supported him. It gets old to them. But it is just that, low-hanging fruit. Can't you find something else? Now, I say that with the utmost hypocrisy on this program, because here we are
talking
about Donald.
You know what, though? I mean, if you look back, Tina Fey's impersonation of Sarah Palin was hilarious.
But they didn't ring with it.
No,
every episode for 8, 9, 10 weeks.
And is it not part of the big ordeal as Alec Baldwin says he'll quit doing the impersonation if Trump comes out with his tax returns? Is that a real thing?
Yeah, this is what I was going to say. Here's what's important about this.
Do tell.
It's not. First of all, I would say we still have quite a ways to go before we have as many Trump impersonations as we had George Bush, Al Gore impersonations, right? How quickly we forget America.
Yeah.
We were a little bit light on Obama, but we also forget, like, Obama was pretty chill. Like, he didn't, like, I'm saying they were light on Obama.
This is the reason they were light on Obama.
Because Obama's not sending weird sexist tweets or grabbing women in inappropriate places?
Obama was untouchable. He was the sacred cow for a while because the first person to play him, they came out against saying it was essentially blackface because he was not African American.
Right.
In fact, they hired a cast member
to play him.
Mostly because he could impersonate Obama and he was African American. So there was several years there where they were afraid to touch Barack Obama.
How quickly do we forget Dana Carvey? Not gonna. 1,000 points alive.
1,000 points
right,
alive.
Right. We forget. Like this is.
Or Daryl Hannah and Bill Clinton. I talked about that last week.
That's right.
bulletproof.
Right. You know, do you remember when? It was they ran the skit, like, in all fairness, they ran the skit before Clinton won. They ran the race to see who loses to Bush. Do you remember that?
Right.
Yeah.
and they ran that multiple times.
I think
part of this is it's Baldwin.
It is.
You were just talking about how personalities have kept the show afloat. It was huge news for someone who already headlines his own television shows to say, I'm going to do this. I dislike, right? Like, in a sense, this is the boxing match. It's not SNL versus Trump. It's Alec Baldwin saying, I am big enough and gross enough in my own ways, right? And like I am steely enough to say, I will, on this huge American platform, attack the president. And the president-elect is going to attack me back, right? And if, well, and I, if Trump, right. I think, and if Trump releases his tax reports, I'll quit.
And you've hit the nail on the head. This is no longer just about satirizing popular.
It's two TV guys swinging.
It's
at
each not
other.
Even two TV guys. I think it's a permissive network and a show that's looking to achieve something more than a laugh.
Yeah.
And I think Donald sees it that way, and I think he's calling it just that. So as much as I think it's a bit ridiculous to attack SNL, I think it's very foolish to dismiss a lot of the intent behind the comedy right now. I think it's different than it has been before.
It is. It's
been. Before it was straight satire. It was an attempt to play light of even our most embarrassing moments as a society. It was used periodically for change, but there's an anger and a resentment and an intent right now to undermine him as a man. I'm not going to say undermine him as a president because I really think it's personality specific. I don't think people are trying to tear apart the institution of democracy like some people do.
Right, yeah.
I think unintentionally they may be.
I think that we forget that there, previous to the Donald, there have been articles and articles and data all about – like we forget – like it's so funny that we think this is just Donald specific because it's not Donald specific. What we forget is like – Saturday Night Live has always weighed in on the presidency and has been seen as an influencer of elections. That when we paint somebody as a certain – right? That was one thing with like the whole Bush-Gore thing.
Right.
Like we forget like Will Ferrell was hysterical but likable.
Right.
Like remember Come on America, Be My Buddy?
Yeah.
Remember that? Like that was his final arguments? Like they were talking about like Gore finishes and he's talking about like, you know –
I'd like to say some more Nigerian names.
Yeah, do you remember what he says? He says, look, America, I'm going to give you a dollar. Remember that? And he goes, Al Gore's going to give it to a tree.
Yeah.
Like, so be my buddy, right?
Yeah.
Like, they made Bush likable. And Bush's numbers did what?
They went up.
They went up, right? Like, and I'm not saying that those are, remember how we talk about causality and mm-hmm. all this? I'm not saying that, but there are articles written about this. I do think there is more vitriol in the Baldwin – and this is because what? We have so much supplemental media. Like we see Baldwin tweeting super angry stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And then we see him on Saturday Night Live and you're not able to just be like, ha, ha, ha.
We'd see him – recorded tapes of him cussing at his daughter.
That's right.
You know, and so it seems like from different ends of the spectrum.
Two angry men fighting. Yeah.
But I do think that we are – and I'm gonna ask you to confront this directly, Rob. Do you not feel that it has changed for SNL and for these actors, that there's much more of a motive here than just comedy?
I feel like there is a very pervasive feeling across the country that at least I have never felt. It may have been there. It may have been there. That for some reason we are in a dire situation. Right? And I'm not saying that we're in a dire situation.
Mitch is complete.
Mitch is like watching us
what
on
are you
Facebook
doing?
Live instead.
I'm watching
you cannot
you on
watch
Facebook.
Us on a 7-second delay. We've got a dump button in case Rob cusses again. We got
anyway, so to answer your question is, I do think personally I feel like there is a different tone in general, right? And I see it on both sides of the aisle that sort of like this election was for all the cookies, right? Like we've swung this way and we've swung this way, and now congratulations, we've pushed America to the polls the polar opposite, right? And so now someone was going to win, and someone did win. So half the country, right, is mortified, and some of the people who voted for him, I don't know. God help me. I pulled the lever. Right? And so there's like – and part of it may be the fact that we have more access to the vitriol on social media, even more than we had in past elections, right? Like reading the paper versus seeing all of your friends be like, I hate him. I love him. I hate him. I love him. I hate – right? It's exhausting. So I do think let's say I was going to – I had the chance to be on Saturday Night Live, okay? And I was one of those just geniuses, because you are a comedic genius if you end up on Saturday Night Live, even if you are not in the beloved circle, right? Mm-hmm. You don't get there by accident.
Even if you get one season.
That's right. You didn't end up there by accident. I am thinking, like, I get to be on a culture-shaping show. Like, this show has affected American culture forever, right? For a long time. And if I feel strongly about the president, I'm gonna go there now. And so I definitely think we feel that. I think we feel it because there are stronger feelings about Donald. People feel more strongly about Donald, love him or hate him, than about Obama, love him or hate him, than about Bush, love him or hate him, than about Bush Sr., love him or hate him, right? You see what I'm saying? Like, these are stronger feelings all the way around, and they get amplified when they're on television.
Well, I
that's,
noticed –
that's what The Shrink says.
I had kind of hoped, and I picked up on something here, and this is the irony to me of what's happening with SNL. And I'd kind of hoped Dan was going to be here this weekend, but I attended a function, and at this function – I wound up in a room full of about 60 people, the majority of them millennial or post-millennial artist, drama, actors, right, kind of folks. And the nature of the environment was geared to where people were inserting, kind of a Mad Lib kind of thing, mm-hmm, and people were inserting content for the purpose of humor. And in this meeting, silly things were thrown out all the way around, and it elicited laughter from the audience, you know, from the crowd of people and stuff like that, until someone makes a Trump reference. And the Trump reference was a funny reference. It was a play on his use of the word bigly.
Sure.
And there was almost not even permission to laugh in the room, right, as if it's not even funny.
Right.
Like, you just reminded me of something that's not even funny.
Right, right.
And the irony is, here's Saturday Night Live driving at home trying to still be funny with something that arguably I don't think the motive is to be funny anymore. You have the people who like and support Trump who don't think it's funny anymore.
Right.
And apparently
people who don't like Trump who don't think it's funny anymore. It's not funny because none of it's funny. We're only being reminded of something we don't like.
Right.
So my question is, why continue? And so that gives credence to the fact that the motive's different. Why continue? Yeah. If it's no longer funny, and arguably Alec Baldwin's impersonation of Donald Trump's no longer funny just because it's so familiar. You know, I love that song until the radio plays it 80 times.
Yes.
Yeah, if I'm a Republican, I'm mad at it because it's reminding me that the dude I voted for is that dude.
Right.
And if I'm Democrat, it's reminding me I lost to this dude.
Right.
Like, it's not funny.
I think it's just indicative of the Hollywood climate right now. The actors and how they feel like they can just be blatantly disrespectful. And there's
Didn't
no
anybody
consequence.
Think it was funny when he said, let's not talk about the pee-pee? Am I the only one who thought that was funny?
Listen, there's certain things that
are
funny.
I mean, fart jokes
are
still funny, right?
Yeah, they're still funny to my children.
you're telling me you didn't laugh when he said, I don't want to talk about
Did you like the movie Office Christmas Party?
I hated it.
So, okay. You know, it's not always funny, is it, Rob?
It was the worst. It was the worst.
It's not always funny, evidently.
It's not always funny.
I think you got me with my own review. I think SNL would be wise to.
You can check out Rob Alderman's movie reviews at facebook.com/$5 film.
But
that's the number $5 film.
By the way,
Slinky says that our Buzz live stream went down and it gave way to a countdown to the next Fox News update. And he says he thinks it's a right-wing conspiracy to stop us from speaking our mind on our show.
Oh,
somebody call the radio station.
Come on, the Buzz.
I would apologize to our listeners, but they can't hear us.
That's right.
So to all of our viewers,
sorry.
Inundate Steve Hart. It's probably because of what I said about Steve Hartline at the beginning of the program.
No, it isn't.
Big Brother shut you down.
So, listen, I think our producers are on it.
Mr. Producer, what happened?
What happened, Mr. Producer?
Fox News took over Man Up America.
Oh, no.
I was asleep.
Fox News took us over. Our producer is sleeping through our current program.
Is it that
We're
bad?
Live. I mean, we're cooking. We're fine
it was
on
a
our
great
end.
Nap.
It's obviously
our
Steve Hartline's fault.
Our producer had an awesome nap.
Our producer's working on it, but our producer, Josh, here, loves Saturday Night Live. While you're working, what do you think about the... Do you think they need to give it a rest for a while, Alec Baldwin, or just keep trucking?
If it works.
Oh,
is it working? I don't. That's what I can't figure out. Like I said, I was in a room full of people who obviously do not like Donald Trump this weekend, and it's no longer funny to them.
I just got a text. If we ever think people don't get this anymore, right? Okay. I got a text from a dude I worked for when I was in high school. I haven't talked to this guy in like 3 or 4 years, and he just texted me, "You're bigger than this. Stand up, slam the chair on the desk, yell 'I love Nickelback,' and walk out."
Walk out.
And I almost did.
That's sound advice.
He was my boss for a long time. These thoughts, they go deep.
Right.
When an old boss tells you to do something, you just almost do.
You just do.
Well, when it comes to Nickelback, we all have to sever ties.
I love Nickelback.
What is Chad Kroeger doing anymore? Is he still? Are they still touring?
Was he not married to Avril Lavigne?
I am positive that wherever he is,
Avril Lavigne's dad.
He is just chilling. Yeah. I am sure he is just chilling out.
Well, this is what's funny, and we're completely on a rabbit trail. It's what makes our show great. So Chad Kroeger, the lead singer of Nickelback, did that album with Carlos Santana where he sang one song. Right?
Oh, was he on that? No.
They quickly replaced him with another guy. Who I can't remember what band it was, but they sounded the exact same.
Rob Thomas and Santana.
It wasn't Rob Thomas though. It was Chad Kroeger and some the white headed guy.
Not Black Magic Woman like they should have had.
What songs did Nickelback sing?
What songs did Nickelback sing? I know Photograph because it was the worst song ever written.
Okay,
that's the only one that I know.
It's Photograph, and it actually starts with "I look at this photograph."
Sometimes I think it makes me laugh.
See, look, even you know it. It's one of those absolutely horrible songs. Like, I'm not a Katy Perry fan, but I probably can sing Firework because it's shoved in my face so often. Oh, that was Nickelback.
So can I make my point about the Trump?
What was so bad about
SNL?
Nickelback other than being Canadian?
Sometimes
that's enough. Yeah,
that's enough. Right?
That is enough.
Yeah. Yeah.
To all my friends in Canada watching on Facebook Live, you live in Canada.
They hook up their horse and cart. They go to the school later on. They're going to go to
little malt shopping.
Roll a little round hoop with a stick.
Oh, my goodness. Perfect time for a break.
Yeah.
When we come back, we're actually going to ask ourselves the question, why do artists hate Trump so bad? Why so much drama in art? Did you see what I did there?
Yeah, it was good.
I did there?
It was good. We'll be right back.
You're listening to Man Up America Talk 101.3 The Buzz. Maybe WTNB Television, Facebook Live right here in the studio.
Go to the malt shop.
We'll be back in a minute.
Spin
them. Hoop.
So, how's the new job?
Love it. But it's not just a job, it's a career.
Life insurance? Love?
I told you Woodman Life is really active in the community, right? They support all kinds of community improvement projects. How's your job, by the way?
Don't ask.
Begin your financial career today with Woodman Life by calling 423-790-2847.
Woodman of the World Life Insurance Society of Omaha, Nebraska. Woodman Life, standing strong for generations.
The good Dr. Jay Adam here, talking to all the gentlemen out there. For those of you with wives, girlfriends, even mothers, which would make all of you, you need to call 423-472-8887 and talk to the good folks at Bliss Day Spa. Nothing says I love you like the special treatment, the VIP treatment of the services of Bliss Day Spa. Call them today, 423-472-8887. Tell them the good doctor sent you from Man Up America. Are you looking to refinance your home, or perhaps you're in the market to actually purchase? Take it from the good doctor, Jay Adam. There's no need to go far and wide to look for mortgage help. Call 339-8086, Home Mortgage Solutions, LLC, right here in Cleveland. Their team's prepared to help you with lending, with refi options. Just give them a call, 339-8086, and tell them the good Dr. Jay Adams sent you.
Woodman Life has been keeping its promises to members for more than 100 years. That means we've survived the Great Depression, Black Friday, and all the other ups and downs our economy has faced. In good times and bad, we're strong and stable. We're an organization your family can count on. At Woodman Life, we've always believed that slow and steady really does win the race.
Our conservative investment philosophies are just one part of the strength of our organization. What really makes Woodman Life strong is the trust and loyalty of our members.
Contact your local Woodman representative today by calling 423-790-2847. With three offices serving Southeast Tennessee, your Woodman representative standing by to help you.
Woodman of the World Life Insurance Society of Omaha, Nebraska. Woodman Life, standing strong for generations.
Look at this photograph. Every time I do, it makes me laugh. How did our eyes get so red? And what the hell is on
the way? No! Can't do it! No! No!
Mitch got so excited.
I did.
Mitch was like, oh, I do know I this know band.
He's like, this is my favorite band.
So this is my bring back.
I didn't realize who they were.
I really want to point out that she is making my correlation between Shy Trumpers and Nickelback purchasers a lot.
I'm not a Shy Trumper.
Not fair. Not fair. I would never put Nickelback on Donald Trump.
But all your friends are.
Most of them are excited Trumpers.
They're in the malt shoppy right now, like, did you hear what they said?
Did you just see that?
I can't believe what they said.
No, I didn't.
We're all living in an Archie comic here on Man Up America. All right, so that was just a little love. Producers, I think we kept that under 20 seconds, so I think we're legit, or eight bars
yeah,
or whatever.
No, it was good. We were fine.
I don't think we'll be flagged by the BBC again for playing the iguana video.
I want to say a thing here.
I had a great cover of it.
Mitch was pointing out that we have comments.
We do.
Right, and so we've got a comment
Where
here.
Are our comments?
Dee McCarthy, who is up in
We're dropping names now.
Oh, I mean, her name's on there.
Okay.
You know, Dee McCarthy, who is a good friend of mine. In fact, did I perform her wedding? I performed your wedding.
Did you officiate?
I was the minister. I officiated
Uh-oh.
That wedding. Yeah.
Okay.
You're like, dearly beloved, bring forth the ale.
The problem is, so many times I get asked to play music at weddings, and then other times I get asked to officiate. Right. I forget which was which. But anyway, Dee pointed out, and I think rightly so, she says, I can understand Shy Trumpers. Who wants to be labeled racist, xenophobic, and isolationist, let alone despicable? Right? So, like, what we're seeing is people, right, there is not just, hey, I don't want you to know my business, which is some Shy Trumpers, but there's some people who feel like if I associate with this thing, there will be a public – and I want to talk about that because I have a buddy who will remain nameless because he's not on this. I didn't forget.
So
she said
talk
I forgot.
About Steve.
I'm in trouble forgetting that I officiated her wedding. I'm sorry. So,
newsflash: Rob has had several friends this episode.
It was wonderful. But wait, there is a guy who I like very much, who is very liberal and dislikes Trump very much, and he's outspoken about it. And when he posts something about Trump, he gets a ton of, I guess, anti-Trumpers on there, right? And it is terrifying, like the bile, the things they say, right?
It's
terrifying, right?
Right.
And so, like, this isn't like let's hug it out. Sorry, we lost, right? Like, I like this guy; he's pretty even keeled. But his friends who post on this, I'll get on there and be like, "You guys are like terrifying me. I thought this was reserved for like far right wing conspiracy people, right?" I think that Dee brings up a really good point, right? That there's starting to be like these ramifications. It's not like, "Hey, we're all Americans."
Right.
Sorry, your guy lost, our guy won, or our guy lost, your
guy
won.
We're all for the process.
But like that's America, and we're gonna make America better together, right? Mm-hmm. Well, that's not happening, right? Because we're at these polar opposites. Now there is like this anger from some people, not from everybody, from some people that maybe is forcing some of these Shy Trumpers into hiding.
I think even funnier than that is, or maybe scarier than that, is these Shy Trumpers that are afraid to be labeled racist, xenophobic, and whatever else are still thinking, it was better than Hillary. So I'm going to go with that option rather than her.
Yeah, whether you like it or not, whether you believe it's true or not, a lot of folks said Donald Trump is a horrible person, but Hillary is a murderer.
Right.
Right.
That's how they felt.
They felt she was directly responsible and knowingly responsible for deaths. And that was a moral high ground, not, you know,
a moral high ground
that people took. And you can be as belligerent as you want to be. I think we are very polarized right now. I think it's great that here in Cleveland, Tennessee, there's a lot of camaraderie across party lines that builds some good dialogue, but nationally we are not there. In fact, I am looking for right now a clip that I watched this weekend, and newsflash, I watched the Young Turks.
Okay.
For those people who are familiar with the Young Turks, Young Turks is a very liberal show, kind of like this.
Yeah, it's not
and
too different.
And it is overtly anti-conservative,
right.
Very progressive, and progressive in the complete stereotype.
They're not as funny as we are.
I would agree. But
it's similar. It is a similar show.
And I'm trying to find this quote.
You're similar, Young Turks.
Clip.
You're similar.
But if you've watched the Young Turks, they're not very good people in regards to how they treat other folks, especially the one gentleman on there. And I've got a clip that if I can find it as we talk, I'll bring it up. But it becomes so characteristic of how, even though I can't stand a word he says, I think he openly reveals how a lot of people feel.
I think so, too.
So oftentimes you can find the litmus test in the social groups that give you some insight into just exactly how people feel about issues. And he kind of overtly spits it out. And this past weekend, I'm watching their show from January 4th, and he takes on the issue of why people, and I'm trying to bring it up here, why people so often progressively move through issues but resist others. And he pins it and alleges that it's all about hate, that people have to hate. And if people don't hate, they don't essentially have anything to do. So here's what he had to say. Presented by La Quinta. Give us one second here. I'm not going to play their ad for you, but I am going to play. Oh, come on. I'm getting through their ads here.
Just kidding.
Well, and that's the problem with us, right? We're not popular enough yet to have so many
to have
ads.
So many ads.
We need all these ads.
But I do want to hear this clip because this guy.
When are we going to get more popular, man?
Well, when you come on the show more consistently, our insurance is up, right?
Yeah.
When you're on here,
I think that's kind of where we are. For people aren't for people anymore. You don't want to see someone else succeed and do well. Generally,
right?
You know.
All right, we're
going
to rewind to this clip here, and this is how this gentleman.
I wish everybody would succeed.
Here we go.
I know.
I don't know if y'all can hear,
but that on her own, because she does the same gobbledygook all these brainwashed people do, and then I love the sinner, but I hate the sin, but I hate, but I'm judging you, judging based on who you are, and you're filled with this, and you're filled with that. So no, your religious leaders, they do it in all the religions. Fill your head with, okay, these are the people that are the outsiders and we hate them. And it used to be that if you got divorced, you were in that group. Ooh, God hates divorce.
If you were in an interracial marriage.
Interracial marriage. God hates interracial marriage. They justified slavery with it. By the way, slavery.
So he really hones in and blames religion and anybody with a religious background. He's very atheistic in his approach. But he essentially says religion has indoctrinated a large portion of the American people to hate those who are not like them. But listen as he continues, and how he even plays the caricature of someone different.
Slavery's in the Bible. Read the book, okay? Read the book. It's in the Quran. It's in the Bible. It's in all these different things, okay? So when it was needed to justify hatred, as it is today, they always do it, right? So, and they always selectively quote it, because there are also wonderful parts of the Bible, wonderful parts of the Quran, and the Torah and all that stuff. There's also bad parts that it's inconvenient. So we don't quote the divorce anymore. Why? Because now everybody's divorced. So that's it's harder to hate your neighbor. I mean we're all good Christians. Maybe somebody from a different religion or a different color, right? So because I gotta hate my religious leaders tell me to hate. I gotta hate. So but don't blame me. What are you blaming me for? The devil's attacking me.
So you're angry, and I understand that rage, but.
Shrimp and lobster, and have you ever eaten it? Because
A lot of this was born out of his distaste for what a gospel singer had to say and then her subsequent non-appearance on the Ellen DeGeneres program. But what I couldn't hone in on was a portion of his clip where every time he talks about and plays the role of someone who's religious or conservative, every other phrase he goes, as if to characterize him as an ignorant Southern person. You know, and he plays this role like where he says, you know what, I'm against gays. And then he goes, but my nephew's gay, so I don't know if I'm against that anymore. And then he kind of plays this role. And even though I watch the show and he irks me all the time because of what he does, I think a lot of folks feel the way he does.
Right, sure.
Internally, this is exactly what they tell themselves. Now, maybe they're kind to my face and to your face and everybody's face around town. And they say, well, no, I really, you know, I think that there's some middle yada, yada, yada. I don't know. I think there's a lot of people who feel like he does. They feel that Southern, particularly Christianity, has given permission for people to hate, right, whether it's blacks, whether it's gays, whether it's the arts, whatever the case may be, and that they feel we have been brainwashed, as he says, into a system that has promulgated a Donald Trump. And
well, I mean, how many times do you hear the phrase, not in the Bible Belt? No, not in the Bible Belt. You know, so I think that I can understand how people would maybe draw that conclusion, but I don't believe that that's the way that's the actuality of the situation.
At the malt shoppy, that's not how you roll.
That's not
how we talk.
So, once again, I think where we are is and this is where I was getting at. We've talked a lot about shy Trumpers, okay?
We should.
What about...
They powered an entire election.
What about the shy atheist?
Sure.
What about the individual that isn't ready because of the social pushback they would get in the South to openly say what this guy said?
Right.
You're ignorant, you're stupid, and because I'm more intellectually enlightened, I'm better than you.
Right. No.
What about those people who believe that about themselves every day?
Right. Absolutely. That's what I was telling you on this Facebook page. I see it. I don't want to say this dude's name. Like I said, he's a great guy.
I don't know if I know anyone like that.
But these people are crazy. Like to the point where I private messaged him and said, I'm so thankful.
Our viewership just tripled on Facebook.
I'm thankful that you aren't like your friends. This is what I told him. And he's like, they're pretty good people. They've just been like, they're the people that have been the victims of this mentality that we're talking about right now, right? And so now they're raging against it openly, publicly, right? Like, they've made their way into a big city where it is more accepted. And now from over there, it's...
They're raging against the machine.
They're raging, right? You ever listen to the dollop?
Daisy?
The dollop, D-O-L-L-O-P. Here's the deal, everyone. I cannot, in good conscience, recommend that you listen to The Dollop. It's a podcast that uses extreme language that many of you will not like.
Things your ears should never hear.
That's correct. That's right. But I will say this. If you want to really remind yourself what some of the people in this country have had to put up with, The Dollop is fantastic because The Dollop is two comedian friends where one takes a story from American history and reads it to the other one who has no idea what he's about to hear.
So it's like drunk history.
It's similar, right? And so they talk about these things. They talk about the civil rights movements. They talk about slavery in America. They talk about the homosexual plight to be seen as Americans, because they just pick stories about people and then tell these. And it's really interesting, right, as you listen to this, because these are like all stories he takes from Wikipedia that are like factual. So it's a really incredible story to listen to aside comedic commentary, right? It's like an ENTP's dream. Right, because it's like the facts of history alongside like all the passion and irreverence of comedy, right?
Right.
As I've been listening to this, though, right, there is this common theme, right? And this is the common theme. A lot of the men in power in the United States have done everyone that don't have power no favors, right? Over and over and over and over again, right? And that is one side of a story. That is not also many people in power in this country have done incredible things to feed the homeless, to right. help others, to do incredible things, right? So the danger in a polarized society is that everything becomes one side of a story, right? Mm-hmm. Instead of a, you know, right. like many, we forget. I, you know, we do a lot of work with United Way, as do you, as do probably Mitch, I don't know. But most of the malt shoppy women are givers to
well,
United
I
Way.
Appreciate
that. Was
that.
Really sexist. Continue.
So, no, they are, right?
So, I'm not offended. It's
so
fine.
What I'm saying is, right? I should have said the people.
Some
the
people
shopping.
Do good. Some people do bad with
right.
power.
Right.
I made a note on this program once before that one of the fundamental breakdowns between liberalism and conservatism is the idea that evil exists.
Right.
And that self-interest will always be.
Yeah.
And that a lot of the conservative movement is based on how can we
sure.
keep any one person from having too much power
right.
Right. as opposed to the liberal mentality that says we should all share power.
We should all share power. Exactly.
So we've had that
and that's
conversation.
And that's what I was getting at is yeah. that what's really interesting is if you look at numbers from the nonprofits in this country, if the right-wing evangelical Christians stopped giving
pulled
to
out,
nonprofits
right.
like two-thirds of
things
them go
collapse.
Away on day one.
Well, right. benevolence is the purest form of social justice and will always right. be. But
and yet, and those are the same people, though, right, or same culture mm-hmm. that this guy on the Turks is railing against.
Right.
Right.
Well, what we're seeing with the polarization, I think what's happening with the artistic community and the actors in Hollywood is kind of bringing things to a head. And I told you guys at the beginning of the program that I was going to kind of posit something for you to think about. Now, I'd intended today for us to take a little bit of time, but we're running out of time
uh-oh.
To talk about Martin Luther King's legacy. We'll pick that up tomorrow if you're watching us on WTMB or Facebook Live, because I think it's important for us to
absolutely.
Know part of his legacy. But when it comes to polarization, a lot of times we don't go back deep enough into why we're at different places. We want to make everything superficial. So we say, well, the actors in Hollywood, and I've been guilty of this too, actors in Hollywood are very wrapped around homosexual causes because the prevalence of homosexuality in the artistic community statistically, and therefore they're issues driven, and that's what causes the polarization. But the truth of the matter is a lot of them are very diverse. If you switch policy issues, that changes. But one thing that's true, and I think what has built such a head between the artistic community and Donald Trump is a fundamental difference, and it's this. In the arts, creation can take place without competition. Things can be fostered from nothing. Everyone can excel. It's obvious. It's arguably one of the most naturally socialistic communities that can exist. Everyone can flourish, and we create. And creativity in and of itself can exist without competition.
Right.
When you get over into business, that's not the case.
Right.
So competition and creativity are philosophical perspectives, lenses of life that we look through. And the artistic community looks through one that's not very cognizant of competition, and competition looks through one that's not very cognizant of creation. So if we get to the polar ends of the spectrum and you're the business guy that believes in order for you to succeed, someone has to fail, and you're that guy, it is very hard to build a bridge to understand the guy who has
fundamentally does not share that view.
He doesn't share that view. He believes we all can get in a room. We all can be creative. We all can grow, succeed, love each other, be passionate, and everyone wins. Love wins, everyone wins, you know, kind of mentality. It's hard for them to understand each other.
Right.
Now,
and one side thinks one side thinks the other is ignorant, and one side thinks the other is cruel.
Cruel, right?
Absolutely.
cruel and naive. Right?
And the truth of the matter is they both exist symbiotically, and they have for ages. And a lot of folks will realize there's elements of competition even to art. And a lot of folks will definitely say there's definitely creativity.
It's like our competition with the Young Turks.
Absolutely.
They don't even know it's going on, but they will soon.
It's happening. On like Donkey Kong.
I'm going to be tweeting at the Young Turks.
Well, when we get
all the
flagged
time.
By the BBC for airing the content,
yeah.
We'll definitely be on there. Hey, listen, sorry, we're out of time today, guys. Tune in tomorrow here on WTNB. We'll be back Thursday on Talk 101.3 The Bus with Brian Graves. That's all we have today, and we're out.